Hi and welcome to part 4 of the laptop GPU modding adventure. In the parts before, you saw how I soldered some wires to the I2C bus to get the temperature and power readings from the laptop's GPU via amps. I continued with the heatsink modification in part 3 to gain some temperature headroom on the via amps. And finally, I will present you my results of the shunt mod made to my laptop's RTX 2070 GPU in this video. Before I start to show you the soldering process, we need to talk about the stock hardware situation and also about silicon quality a bit. The stock 115W RTX 2070 refresh installed in my laptop was tested with different games and times by benchmark. It achieved a graphic score between 7700 and 7800 points in TimeSpy, which is right where you would expect this laptop GPU. In the first part, I said that an RTX 2070 desktop achieves a graphic score of 9300, but an attention-paying subscriber of mine told me that it's only true for factory overclocked variants of the desktop RTX 2070. The regular RTX 2070 Founders Edition does achieve a graphic score of 8700 points only. We should keep that in mind when we come to the raw non-overclocking numbers. Speaking of overclocking, we come to the topic of silicon quality. And this is a sad one in case of my modding laptop right here. As I told you in the first video, I bought the modding laptop as a spare machine without extended warranty for this video project. Comparing it to my daily laptop, it turned out that the GPU silicon quality, or bin, is not the best, unfortunately. It can only run a pretty underwhelming plus 150MHz GPU core clock in TimeSpy and up to plus 700MHz on the video memory until it crashes. My daily laptop, on the other hand, can run plus 200 and plus 1000 without any hiccups. That means the GPU for this project isn't a good overclocker, unfortunately. But that's always the risk with hardware. Welcome to Silicon Lottery. Long story short, the GPU in question can provide us with an overclocking baseline of 8450 points in TimeSpy at best. By the way, a friend of mine got a quite astonishing RTX 2070 GPU in his Apex 15. He can run up to plus 250 on the GPU core and close to plus 1100 on the video memory, which enables him to reach more than 1900 points in TimeSpy just from simple overclocking out of his stock 115W GPU, which is amazingly good. As I said in part 1, our goal would be to beat the desktop RTX 2070 and if I can also some of the factory overclock cards. I took the average TimeSpy graphic score of 9300 points from the notebookcheck.com website as reference for this extended goal. Coming to the shunt mod. The goal of a shunt mod is to increase the power draw of the GPU. Since there are power limits which can't be exceeded, you basically have to modify the power measuring circuitry. Measuring the power draw is done by multiplying the input voltage with the current flowing through the shunt resistor. And the current can be computed by observing the voltage drop across a defined resistance, which is the shunt resistor. The higher the current, the bigger the voltage drop. This way the GPU can compute the power draw and limit its power consumption. In our case, that's 115W TGP, which stands for total graphics power. When we want to raise the power draw, but can't simply access a power limit slider in overclocking softwares, we need to find another way. The easiest solution is to alter the part of the equation the GPU assumes a constant value, which is the shunt resistance. After we lower the resistance of the shunt resistor, the GPU will calculate a lower overall power draw across this shunt, and because modern GPUs are all power limited, it tries to fill up the missing watts, till it hits 115W again. Therefore, the GPU will still report 115W power draw, but is drawing more power instead. As a side effect, we can't trust the power readings reported in monitoring softwares anymore. But I can make use of the I2C bus mod I made in part 2 of this project to see the real power draw reported by the VRMs. The readings are quite noisy, but can be smoothed out using the recorded logs later. Okay, now let's take a look at the mainboard. Next to the GPU section, you can see two components labeled RS1 and RS2. Those are our shunt resistors. RS1 measures the total graphics power, aka TGP, and RS2 measures the GPU core power draw only. In our case, we got an RTX 2070 with 115W TGP, so RS1 is seeing the full 115W, while RS2, on the other hand, will only see roughly 90W for the core. The missing 25W are consumed by the video memory and other I/O stuff. As the first stage, I plan to aim for roughly 125W, but because there are no appropriate shunt resistors available, I will need to stack 2 or maybe 3 resistors on top of each other in parallel. Using the original 5mΩ and an additional 4070mΩ resistor, I should be able to come in at around 4.5mΩ in total, or 127W. Well, at least I thought so, but more after this little time lapse. The good news is, the laptop booted just fine and I got a higher score than before. But only by a very small amount. Analyzing the log data from the VRMs showed why the score was so low. I was running at only 6W more power draw than stock, not 12W. I was expecting double the increase, so I soldered in a second 4070mΩ resistor in parallel to see if we see the strange behavior again. At the end of this process, the three stacked resistors were soldered in nicely, but do look quite funny, to be honest. The laptop booted just fine and the score was higher again. The log data revealed that we got roughly 127W using this little shunt tower, so it is still roughly half of the power draw increase I would expect. Because I was nowhere near my 140W goal, I needed to purchase some more shunt resistors. So in the end, I ordered some additional 12mΩ, 5mΩ and 4mΩ ones. Because this video will be quite long anyway, I will skip any further explanations and come to the results straight away. I tried out some more combinations down to 3mΩ in total, and what you can see here in this plot are the resulting real power draws of all my attempts. What is very noticeable is that the top two configurations draw roughly the same power, which was strange since they got different resistances. The reason for was that the second shunt resistor was limiting both configurations. I changed the second shunt resistor to a 4070mΩ by 5mΩ configuration earlier, and this turns out to be a natural limiter to around 150W power draw in total. But again, it still made no sense why the first shunt behaves like this. The 5mΩ and 12mΩ combination should never reach 150W, but 140W instead, according to the previous strange behavior at 121 and 127W TGP. The whole computations beforehand don't match the results, and I'm still trying to understand why this is the case. It could be a wrongly labeled resistor involved, or the power reading circuitry is more complex than just measuring the voltage drop across the shunts. I will try to investigate it further, but maybe one of you guys got an explanation what's going on here. Let me know in the comment section. Finally, let's take a look at some interesting data I could collect. We saw the VRM power readings before, but what about its temperature? Is my modded heatsink I made in part 3 any good? Well, yes it is. I managed to keep the temperatures low enough to say that the VRM runs in a safe temperature range, even at 150W. And the GPU temperature? Well, it gets really hot. Basically, the 4mΩ shunt mod, so a total of 135W, lets the system run just under the 80-70 degrees centigrade throttle point. As soon as the GPU core hits 80-70 degrees centigrade, NVIDIA Turing GPUs throttle down their clock speed massively. Unfortunately, that happens with the 150 watts shunt mod just after 2 minutes into the stress test. Of course, wow performance improved too, but don't expect any wonders here. Remember, the Founders Edition RTX 2070 desktop got 175 watts and a graphics score of 8700 points in TimeSpy. Of course, we stayed under 8700 points without overclocking. What holds us back in case of the RTX 2070 mobile refresh is not just the core clock, it is also the memory clock. We run at only 11 GB per second instead of the regular 14 GB per second of desktop GPUs. But overclocking gives us some quite nice speed bumps, and we can overtake the regular desktop RTX 2070 quite easily. In fact, we come close to some factory OC variants, but are still some points away from the average 9300 points as seen with the desktop OC cards. In Cyberpunk 2077, our performance improved slightly over the stock RTX 2070 mobile. So it did in Witcher 3 and Shadow of the Tomb Raider, but only if we are not running into a CPU limit, which is sometimes the case here. Lastly, I want to show you my attempts to break the record of the RTX 2070 mobile refresh in TimeSpy. I know, it seems a bit unfair, but all the leading scores on those leaderboards are made under not very practical conditions. So I guess my run was still quite normal. Not sure though. The graphics score I ended with was exactly 9300 points, which was my initial goal to beat. So technically, I did it. Even if the conditions are anything but normal. You can find a link to some of those ones in the video description. After all the effort, I wish my GPU would have been a better bin. A graphics score of 9300 points is pretty much the best my GPU can achieve. But there should be plenty of better bins out there which could hit more than 9500 points easily, maybe even 10k. Well, let's see and wait for another RTX 2070 mobile refresh laptop owner attempt the shunt mod and prove my guess to be true. I got so much more data than just the ones shown. So if you have any questions or miss some informations, let me know in the comments. I will prepare the data for the next part. And I guess the next part will be the final one for this project. If everything works according to plan, I will sand down and polish the surfaces of the modified heatsink and will bring it to a company which will nickel-plate it professionally. With the nickel-plated heatsink, I want to try out liquid metal in this laptop and investigate in which way the temperatures improve at 150 watts and some higher TGPs up to 150 watts. Okay, nothing more to say then. Thanks for watching and see you in the next one. Bye!